All right, what are the best things from England? Cadbury chocolate, Harris yeah. Tweed sport coats, Jaguars, and let's press a button. Here comes Kenneth Branagh from New York, I believe. Did you like being included in that group, sir?
I'm very, very honored and pleased to be included in that group, guys. Sam, and it's very nice to talk to you. I always feel like we've grown up in show business together, so it's always nice to hear from you.
And
to be included next to famous chocolate, too.
Very good. That is very nice of you to say. And since we have grown up in show business together.
One successful.
Well, yes, yeah. Yeah. We're at different tiers.
Well.
But we're both still working. Here's the thing. You've had great success in front of the camera and behind the camera as a filmmaker. That's what I want to talk about. With Dunkirk, you saw Christopher Nolan at work. How big an undertaking was this?
It was absolutely huge. It was a real passion project for him. We know that he can handle the most massive of Hollywood movies, from the Dark Knight trilogy to Inception to Interstellar. But this was a desire to go to the real place, to Dunkirk, to the beach in France where this incredible miracle happened, and to bring as many things in terms of size and scale as possible. So I was playing a commander Bolton. I'm on a jetty, which they call the Mole, and there's Christopher Nolan in front of me, and behind me he is orchestrating planes flying over. There's Tom Hardy, and there's a boat in the back, that's Mark Rylance, and then there's a explosion going on here and underneath the jetty, and in the water and fully submerged are Harry Styles and Finn Whitehead and all these kids, and all of this kind of craziness is going on, and then he's still able to somehow come in and give you the attention that the scene requires to play all this kind of delicacy and intimacy that is part of what the movie is. He goes from human stories, very sort of intimate, close up, to this massive experience of the attack, the full-on attack that was Dunkirk. And so to be watching that close quarters was very impressive. I thought that he was a magician with time. I felt like there was three of him working at once. I certainly learned a very great deal.
Growing up as a schoolboy in England, you know this story, which is widely known in the UK, but not widely known here. What is the miracle of Dunkirk?
The miracle was that there were 400,000 men trapped on the beach. England was 26 miles away. You could see it, but the boats could not get in. They were under attack. Those men were stuck. What did they do? They alerted the civilian fleet. 700 and nearly 800 small boats came. Everything from fishing trawlers all the way down to a canoe. One fella paddled a canoe just to get some men home. Every man, woman, and child who could get on a boat, or drive a boat, steer a boat, row a boat, came across those 26 miles. And in a miracle, 400,000 men, of whom Churchill believed at best we might rescue 40,000, became 340,000 people rescued from that beach by all of the armed forces and all of the civilian boats in the southern half of England. It was a miracle.
You do the work, you go away. Christopher Nolan is in an editing room, I imagine, for a protracted period of time. When you saw the finished product, what did you think?
Firstly, when the first bullet hit, I leapt out of my seat by about a foot. I swear to goodness, the soundtrack and the music and the visceral experience of the film is unrelenting, breathtaking, quite exhilarating. You have to take a moment afterwards because film can't recreate warfare, but this piece of cinema can take you as close to that adrenalized experience as maybe cinema can do, and so he does. It combines that with a sort of emotional power, which is very, very beautiful, I think. He wanted to make a film about young people. It was young people who were there. Last week, I had the great privilege of meeting the veterans who are now 95, 94, 96 years old, and they'd just seen the film, and they told me it was just like that. I was 20 years old, and that's what I did. That was very, very, very affecting, and I think that combination of the epic and the personal and the noisy and the quiet is really a winner.
You made reference to young people. Obviously, Harry Styles, part of the cast, his name getting a lot of attention. And what was interesting to me was Christopher Nolan telling me he had no idea who he was. Did you know who he was?
I knew he was because I had more calls from my two teenage nieces when they heard I'd got this job than in any other single job in my career. Suddenly, I was the most popular uncle on the block. Where will you film it, Uncle Ken? Would you be going to France? Would we be able to help you? Perhaps you could come and be an assistant. Why is that, girls? Oh, nothing. I knew about Harry Styles big time. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Kenneth,
he did a great job in the movie. He did a great job.
They're pushing us along as you and I continue to grow up in show business. What's next for us?
Sam, you're going to come and talk to me. I hope I shall drag you along, kicking and screaming, whether you like it or not, to talk about Murder on the Orient Express, which I had the chance to act in as Hercule Poirot with a significant moustache, which I shall bring a copy of and allow you to wear if you're very well behaved in November of this year when it reaches cinemas.
Terrific, Kenneth Branagh. Thank you very, very much. I think he now
thank you, Kenneth.
He surpasses Shortbread.
Yes, he has moved way up.
Yeah, so, wow. The movie
nice
is in theaters.
What a nice
isn't he?
Guy.
But I tell you what, rarely do you see people that well able to promote a movie.
Right? Yeah.
That was something really good.
Well, he knows the history.